In segments 7 and 8 of the CEA video series, we presented a CEA example on prevention of HIV infection with adult male circumcision in Zambia. Here's another CEA example focused on improving treatment for HIV. What is the cost-effectiveness of adherence counseling for HIV antiretroviral therapy, or ART, in a primary care clinic in rural India as part of a randomized controlled trial, or RCT? This is the nomenclature used for NIH proposals, specific aims. They're the same as research questions, but posed as a statement. Specific Aim 1 measures the cost in this primary care setting of adherence counseling per client receiving the service and per patient year of ART. The second specific aim is to estimate the impact of adherence counseling on HIV disease progression and disability-adjusted life years, or DALYS, over 3 and 10 years. Once again, we're going from cost in the first aim to health effects. Then, in specific Aim 3, we bring it together and calculate the cost per added individual with viral suppression and per DALY averted. Viral suppression is the short-term marker of ART success, which from the point of view of virologists and AIDS clinicians is critical and serves as a bridge to our preferred measure, the cost per DALY averted. For the first aim, again, if we want to get the cost, we look at program, financial, and service records. We quantify the adherence counts and costs, the resources used. We also need to quantify the client years of ART. Before, with male circumcision, we considered clients because it's a one-time intervention. For adherence counseling, it's an ongoing activity, just like for ART, so using patient years as the unit of service. Here's a new challenge. What happens if your staff have multiple roles? They're providing counseling, but also checking meds, doing blood pressure, taking blood samples, and writing clinical notes. They're doing a lot of things. You want to understand the cost of adherence counseling. One possibility is to use a time and motion study where you quantify how staff members spend their time. We developed a fairly simple method with a piece of paper per staff per person per day. The staff record each activity using a code and when it starts and stops. That lets you say, for example, that in a given day, a staff person spent an hour and a half on counseling. The next specific aim is the impact on HIV disease progression and DALYS. You need to portray HIV disease progression as a function of viral suppression. This is difficult clinical progression modeling. It's not economics, but disease modeling is essential here to get at the health portion of the CEA. You need to figure out how to do this yourself, or you may be able to use someone else's estimate of how viral suppression relates to rate of progression, morbidity, and mortality. Remember, this CEA is done as a part of an RCT, so you can get empirical viral load and clinical results for the duration of the follow-up in the RCT, maybe 2 or 3 years. If you want to progress beyond that, then you have to do some clinical progression modeling. Third aim is to calculate the cost effectiveness. This is now familiar to you, I'm sure, so I won't spend time. Here's the basic decision tree format adapted to this CEA. The population is persons with HIV infection receiving antiretroviral therapy. We model 100 individuals. This square represents the decision node, whether or not to offer adherence counseling. So, all 100 individuals are assigned to either adherence counseling or not. Next comes this circle, which is the chance node. Chance nodes show the mix of possible consequences for each option. In this tree, there's only one chance node per option. In most trees, there are many branching chance nodes. For learning, we keep it simple. The upper chance node shows that with no adherence counseling, the likelihood of early death is 0.2 or 20%. So the chance of remaining alive for a long time is 80%. These probabilities always add up to 1. With adherence counseling, the chance of early death is specified as 15%, presumably from the RCT results. Thus, the likelihood of remaining alive is 85%. Next, we calculate how many individuals end up following each path in the tree. Remember that we started with 100 individuals. So, if with no counseling the chance of early death is 0.2, the number in that path is 20, which equals 100 times 0.2. Similarly, the number remaining alive is 80. The two paths in this action option sum to 100 individuals. Below, with adherence counseling in place, the 100 men are divided into 15 who die early, that's 100 times 0.15, and 85 who remain alive for a long time. The difference between action options in these outcomes, adherence counseling versus not, drive both health and cost outcomes for this analysis. This could be said more generally. The differences in the distribution of clinical outcomes influences CEA results. Next, we attach DALYs to each path. The DALY burden due to each early death is estimated at 10, based on studies that portray health status over time with poor ART adherence. Thus, we put 10 next to paths with early death. The DALY burden for alive is estimated at 4. This is based on studies of clinical progression on ART. Note that we do not assume a healthy full lifespan for individuals with HIV infection on ART, but pretty close compared to not being on ART. We calculate the expected DALYs in each path as a product of the number of individuals in the path times the DALYs. For the no adherence counseling option with early death, that is, the first path in the tree, we calculate 200 DALYs as the product of 20 and 10. The next path, alive, has 320 DALYs, which is the product of 80 individuals and 4 DALYs each. Thus, the total of DALYs for no adherence counseling is 520. For the adherence counseling paths, we similarly calculate 150 and 340 DALYs respectively, for a total of 490 DALYs with the counseling. Thus, the adherence counseling averts an estimated 30 DALYs per 100 individuals. That's the health benefit. Adding costs to each path is similar. There are two types of costs. First is the cost to implement the counseling, usually referred to as program or intervention costs. This is $30 per person with the counseling and $0 without. The second type of cost is for HIV medical care, required for individuals as long as they're receiving care in ART. Based on empirical and modeled studies in Africa, we estimate this as $1,200 with early death and $7,000 for long-term ART. The total cost for each path is the sum of counseling and HIV medical care costs multiplied by the number of individuals in that path. In the first path, which is no counseling followed by early death, the estimated total cost is $24,000, which is the product of 20 and $1,200. The next path has a cost of $560,000, which is 80 individuals times $7,000 in medical care costs each. Thus, total costs for no adherence counseling equal $584,000. For the adherence counseling part of the tree, the cost with early death is $18,450, representing mainly the HIV care costs, but also counseling costs. The cost with alive is $597,550 for 85 individuals. The total for the counseling part of the tree is $616,000. Thus, the counseling adds $32,000 per 100 individuals. Since the counseling reduces DALYs and adds costs, we calculate the ICER as the difference in total cost divided by the difference in DALYs. That works out to $1,067 per DALY averted. In most settings, that would be considered cost-effective and perhaps very cost-effective by WHO standards. But remember, these results are hypothetical, and the WHO standards are under review.